Those tasked with the important job of parenting Generation Alpha are likely to be those of Generations X and Y today. While most baby boomers were shaped in households where fewer mums worked outside the home, today the majority of parents are two income earning. Along with the massive increase in the proportion of mums working full-time, expectations towards fathers have also changed, as many have become more actively involved in child rearing. From attendance at parent-teacher nights and class concerts to the school drop-off, pick-up and taking parental leave, it's the dads of Generation Alpha, not just the mums, who are stepping up. So joining me today to discuss the important role that fathers play in their children's lives and in our society is social researcher and director of solutions at McCrindle, Geoff Brailey. Geoff, welcome back to the podcast.
Yeah, thanks, Ashley. Great to be with you, and a really fascinating topic today to chat through. So thanks for having me.
Delighted to have you on for the second week in a row. Our listeners are getting a real treat to hear from you again and your wisdom. We're talking about fathers today, which is fitting because A, Father's Day is coming up this weekend here in Australia, and B, Geoff, you are a father yourself. So I wondered if you would be okay with it, if you could share with our listeners a little bit about your fathering journey so far.
Yeah, and certainly a privilege to talk about being a dad, but also want to honour the dads that have gone before us, and also the mums in our society that play a huge role and have been key in forming our young kids and helping them to mature and grow. But I think for my journey as a dad, I've got three children. My eldest is 9, and then a 7-year-old, and then a 4-year-old. So we're outnumbered is how I often describe it, where my wife and I are outnumbered, and they're smart, they're savvy, and a little bit sassy sometimes, our kids. They've got a good edge to them, but also just a real delight. And I think for everyone who's raising kids, they'd recognize that it's the hardest work you almost ever have to do, but it's also the most rewarding. And so, yeah, really privileged to be able to chat about being a dad today. And really want to thank my dad as well, who's just been a brilliant father and role model to me. And there's many dads that have helped shape my outlook on being a parent, as well as, been at McCrindle 8 years now and been absorbing a lot of stats and stories about parenting and relationships, and particularly read a great book called Generation Alpha that you wrote, Ash. So it's great to be able to chat with you today about this topic as well.
Yeah, I think it's cool that, I mean, I've been with you along that journey. We've worked together for those 8 years, and to see, some of your kids being born in that time, and the journeys, and sometimes they come into the office and we get to meet them, and they're very fun, very cute. So yeah, it's really great, I think, to see how you carry that responsibility as well, of course, everything else you manage here at McCrindle. So it's really great. And yeah, I love the practical insights that you bring alongside, I guess, even that Generation Alpha book and some of the stats and the theory, and then partnering that with the practice. So really delighted that you could share with us today, Geoff. And you've done a little bit of presenting on this topic and podcast, so we thought our audience should hear all your insights as well. And part of what you've been sharing lately, I know, is I guess around understanding for parents, dads and mums, the different stages of childhood in terms of what children go through. So I wonder if you could elaborate on this for our listeners, Geoff, I guess, both from your experience as a father hands-on, but also as a social researcher.
Yeah, I think back to I'm part of Gen Y, and as a kid for me, I grew up as a child, then became a teenager, and then sort of transitioned into adulthood. And for earlier generations, maybe the Gen Xers and baby boomers, it was a bit more just that shift from childhood straight into adulthood. Whereas I think for Gen Alpha kids today, they're certainly going through more stages in that development. They are a newborn, then a toddler, then they become a child, and then they move into those tween years where they're not quite a teenager, but then there are those early adolescent years from about 11 to 14, the middle adolescent years from sort of that 15 to 18, and late adolescence or early young adult kind of years into that sort of even mid-20s. We know that we're up aging, where young kids today have access to digital technology and information at a younger age, but they're also delaging, where they're delaying their aging till later with key kind of major life markers like moving out of home or getting married or being able to, I guess, find that full-time work as they study for longer to secure full-time work. So I think those traditional kind of just three stages of child, teen, adult, those days are over. We've got a pretty a bit more of a blurry transition across some of those journeys, and even the categories that our kids need to develop in today. They're not just developing physically, and that's probably been the traditional marker of adulthood, as baby teeth fall out and adult teeth come through, but even things like today, it's emotional development, it's financial development and intelligence, it's cultural development and intelligence, social intelligence and development, as well as that spiritual and values development that we want to see in our children. And as they grow up into adults, we want to see all of those kind of areas of development occur in our younger children today. So I think there's a lot of pressure on parents for getting kids to develop in all those different areas. And I'm sort of scratching my head sometimes wondering how on earth do you do all that as a parent? But I know there's some great helpful resources and stats out there. So there's plenty, I guess, to chat through and thinking about how do we develop the children we have today in our homes. And yeah, I guess for parents listening, your kids might be at any of those ages or stages. And so, yeah, we'll try and cover off a few little helpful tips as we go today from, yeah, a lot of my mistakes and some of the learnings from our research as well.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's really fascinating, even what you shared there, and we're going to touch on some of the tensions that parents, modern day parents today are facing in this unique kind of context that's shaping Generation Alpha and to navigate the new technologies that they're faced with and all the challenges and benefits that come with that. But I think even around that tension of up aging and delay aging is a good one, because we talk about up aging and we've talked about it quite a lot, I guess, with regards to Generation Alpha. And then I have had people question and go, but there are other aspects in life where they're not progressing as quickly or as fast as previous generations, like you said, moving out of home or even developing maybe life skills, depending on the take that parents have or how hands-on maybe they are or what kind of skills they feel there that are important to develop in the next generation. So it's interesting to navigate some of those tensions. But I guess part of that, of course, and the key responsibility of that is on the parents and is on the mums and the dads. I'd be keen to hear from you, Geoff. I mean, we've titled this podcast The Importance of Involved Fathers. How important do you feel an involved father is in a child's life today?
Yeah, I think there's a lot of benefits from dads being involved, and it really just presents the opposite as well, that there's an opportunity that dads might choose to be disengaged as parents, and there's some benefits from being involved as a father. And so they're really important categories that really do benefit children as they develop. And they're in categories like their social development. It's in their physical health, even is improved, their cognitive development, their emotions, even through to just greater happiness. And so I think any parent that's listening to this, and give that husband a nudge if you're a lady listening to this, a mother, but certainly as dads, if we want to see our children be happier, let's get involved. And involvement can look like so many different things. As examples from some research that talked about, it's about giving time. And so that might be even in those newborn moments, taking time off work to be with the mother and the newborn. It's about being a listening father, being someone that's involved by simply listening. And as dads, sometimes we struggle if we don't have the answers, we just want to get to solutions. But just being able to listen and help our children with decision making. So that might be, which Pokemon card should I trade, or which would be about which Bluey episode is your favorite. Let's have those important conversations with our kids. It's examples like supporting them with homework as well. And I'm a dad with three kids, and my two eldest are in primary school. And so I know the challenge of doing those daily readers if your kids are doing those in those young primary school years. And it's hard work getting through the sort of lesson of learning how to pronounce different words, and they're pretty simple stories, but they take time for those young kids to learn how to read. And so supporting with homework at that stage of life that I'm at, let alone I'm not looking forward to the older years and sort of senior school examples when they come through as they pick subjects. So hopefully they pick the same subjects I did, but I'll let them choose their own adventure. But involvement, I think, really is a key word that describes a parenting style that I think we're seeing the benefits come through around those different development aspects that we want to see in our children. And dads do play a key role. And even just being a good, respectful partner is a key way to be involved as a dad. It's not directly to your child, but it does have benefits of being a respectful and caring partner. So a few examples there, I think, that give some, I guess, some opportunities for dads listening to seize those opportunities to be involved as opposed to disengaged, getting that scrolling on the phone. I'm certainly guilty of that at times, but I think the permission is there to see the benefits if we can seize those opportunities.
Yeah, there's some really great practical tips there. And even on that last one, I think about some of the things that I sometimes read or engage with, even around parenting and, you know, the examples that we set and that whole, like, we kids kind of mirror the actions and the behaviors of their parents, even if they're not telling them. So even just treating partners or family members how you want your kids to treat others is a great way, and they're always watching and they're probably going to treat people the way that they see you treat people in life. So that's really good. I think something else that I think about with regards to this, because we did a little bit of research around this for the Generation Alpha book, and I remember reading a few studies about it, and there was a Macquarie University Faculty of Human Science here in Sydney, actually, and they conducted a study about the importance of fathers in a child's development of resilience. And it found that the research found that fathers who encourage their children to be socially assertive and step outside of their comfort zone may help their children avoid social anxiety in young adulthood. And just how fathers often kind of push their kids maybe a little bit more than sometimes mums do. And I wanted to just read a quote to you, Geoff, which I'll tell you about in a sec. So it's a quote from someone we interviewed for the Generation Alpha book. And it says this, "I often challenge my kids, age 7, 4, and 1, to try age-appropriate risky activities which mum might not think are safe, like skateboards, rope swings, and jumping off jetties. I think small, regular challenges are vital because I know their confidence is linked to their ability to face challenges. I throw them up into the sky, but I'm there to catch them. While, of course, I want to protect and nurture them, I know that encouraging them to try new things, challenge themselves, and step out of their comfort zone, even if they fail, is important to growing their resilience, character, and ability to deal with life's challenges. Teaching my kids to challenge themselves is important because I don't want them to act like emotional babies forever." A very profound quote from one Geoff Brailey, a dad of 3 at the time. So we did interview you even for the book and just got some quotes from real life parents. But yeah, I think that's also a really great quote that you provided there, just around the importance of challenging children and developing that resilience in them. And sometimes, yeah, dads do sometimes a better job of that maybe than mums who maybe want to, in a gender stereotype role, kind of want to nurture and protect a bit more.
Yeah, it's funny hearing you read that back. And I remember sharing that in that process. And I think that last part about emotional babies, I'm really reflecting on kids copy their parents. And so maybe I've got a bit of growth in my emotions. I did see a counselor once about that. And I learned a few things that my emotional development still needs to catch up with my physical age. But I think that's the point, is that going through life's difficulties is actually where we have an opportunity to develop resilience. And so those moments of falling off skateboards or trying to do band performances and getting nervous on a stage and all those different experiences that you might fail at, they're actually okay to put children into those safe environments for kids to fail. We don't want to do real dangerous situations where harm could befall them, but we certainly want to create those opportunities for learning and growth. I think that's a really key part of parenting that I bring. And I am a skateboarder, surfer. I love doing adrenaline-based things, but I'm nearly in my 40s now, Ash, and it's certainly tempering that adrenaline lifestyle. But I certainly love being active and healthy, and those activities are a lot of fun. And it's good fun seeing kids pick up a skateboard or put on the roller skates. My daughter's got those at the moment, and there's a few scraped knees and bumps here and there, but that's just part of, yeah, play. And I think it's okay. I'm all for it.
Yeah, it's so beneficial. I mean, we've even done in our latest Education Future report a big study, and just how important resilience is even for other areas like mental health and just dealing with challenges, whether it's not getting the marks in the HSC or whatever it might be, you know, how we can develop that resilience is really important. I know something else that you looked at with one of the presentations you delivered recently around this topic was, I guess, fathers and their tendency to seek advice. And I think it's interesting by the sheer fact that we're kind of in an era of information overload where we can access so much free and helpful content and advice. Like, you can access podcasts and books and pretty available, like price-wise, if not free, resources about, you know, other people's stories and journeys and learnings. Do you have any reflections or even stats, Geoff, on, I guess, this generation of dads that we have today and how often, you know, dads are going to seek advice on how to be better fathers?
Yeah, it's a fascinating one. I think for men particularly, there's a sense that I'm just thinking about when we're driving somewhere, if we know the way there, we might not use the app. If we don't know the way there, we might not even use a maps app, and we'll just try and figure it out. We're pretty resistant to getting advice. And so I think that just sets the context for this stat, because it's 45% of dads in a 2019 study of 1,000 fathers, 45% of dads had never sought advice about parenting or caring for their children. And that it's astonishing to me. It's probably the stat that's shocked me the most in this year. And I'm surprised on one hand, and yet kind of take it as pretty grounded reality as well, because I think parents really are, you don't kind of get a manual when you have a child, you're just figuring this thing out. And so I think with trends like cultural diversity, where more people are living away from their kind of community that they were born in, and so there's less of that original support community around them, we don't have access to kind of those trusted advisors. And while there's information galore, who do we trust when we're seeking advice, and who's doing it well that we want to hear from? And I think that's probably where for Australian dads, 45% have never sought advice. The encouraging kind of twist to the stat is that for younger fathers, it's down to 29% of fathers with kids under the age of 18, 29% of fathers have never sought advice. So sadly for older parents, older fathers, 57% have never sought advice, those with kids aged 18 or over. So I think as the younger generation of dads is coming through, they're seeking more advice, looking for help, looking for that support. And there are great resources, podcasts out there. It's a great topic to spend some time learning from different parenting styles. There's different voices, there's great books. I love reading Steve Bidoff's books, Raising Boys. That's been a classic. I've read that a couple of times now, trying to figure this thing out with two young boys. And I'm always keen to read books about kind of childhood and youth development as well. So I've read some great books on what it's like to be 14 and all the different kind of books. I've got a big list. If people want to reach out on LinkedIn, I'm happy to send through some that I've found really helpful.
Yeah, that's awesome. And it's just amazing. I think sometimes I just marvel at how much information we do have in this world today. And that comes from a real technologically integrated world, and there are some challenges, especially with young kids, for that. But there's also some benefits for them and for parents as well, which is really cool. I think one thing that we often talk about with regards to raising children is, of course, focusing on them and their life stages. But even, of course, at the same time, parents are going through their own life stages and their own transitions, and they've got their own marriages or relationships that they're living through and navigating, as well as kind of being there and trying to support their children and help them to flourish and thrive. You recently, Geoff, wrote an article about this. I wonder if you could share a little bit of the interesting findings or life stages that you think might be helpful for people maybe listening to go, oh, I feel seen. Yes, that's I can understand, or something, you know, that might help them as they transition maybe through some of those seasons of life.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of data around the stages of kind of marriage. And what I mean by that is we have the median age of marriage, or when people have their first child. So that median age of new birth for men and women. And so I think we can see that kids are learning about relationships and sexuality from those early tween years. Even that 8 to 12 age group is probably in what I would call the exposure years, where they're learning about relationships, sexuality. Then you've got those teens and early 20s, what I would call the preparation years, where people may have kids in those early years. And that's certainly been kind of historically a much younger family forming era, whereas in today's society, in those early to mid 20s and even early 30s, we'd probably call that the celebration years, where there's a lot of excitement about marriage and relationships. And I think that median age of marriage for females is 29.4 years, and for men it's over 30 at 30.8 years. And so I guess the point is that we're pushing back those key life markers. We're not getting married now in Australia until almost on that cusp of being 30. Then we've got what I would call the tired years, which is those early to late 30s. I'm in that period. And I think the reason I'd call this the tired years is this is where people are in those new parent years. And if you've had a couple of kids, you've stayed there for more than a year. You might have been there for 5 years. I've been there 9 years at the moment. So the median age of a new mum for first birth is at 31.7 years. For dads, it's at 33.7 with a total fertility rate of 1.7. We can see that usually it's just under two kids per household. And so parents are staying in those stressful years of sleep deprivation, trying to figure this whole parenting thing out. There's great work pressures in those 30s while people are sort of taking a few significant leaps up the career ladder or really taking on some responsibility from a financial point of view. Maybe there's that large mortgage. And so these are tiring years, and it's not just physical, it's emotionally tiring, where you just don't know what you don't know when you're looking at parents. And yet when you become a parent, you all of a sudden realize what you don't know. And there's a lot to learn around health, around sleep, around play, around development, around digital kind of habits. So you're really trying to figure it out in those tired years. And I've then called the next phase the conflict years, because in those mid-30s to early 40s, unfortunately, marriages in Australia, on average, there's separation after 8.4 years of marriage. And so for women, that's at 39.1 years of age, for men at 41.9 years of age. So it's a really sad part of the story that some relationships do end up in separation. And that's, you can sort of imagine there's a lot of conflict that might get buried in those earlier years, and there's just no time to deal with it. And so I think this is the challenge for people in that stage, is to find that professional support to deal with those key issues that might be a bit hidden. And you think we'll get to it later. Well, later, unfortunately, just sometimes means never. The next phase moving on is into the ultimatum years. Now, it sounds pretty somber, but this is, I guess, the era of endings and new beginnings, where some people enter divorce at 12.2 years after marriage is the average for divorce. And so for females, that's at 43 and men at 45.9. Now, these are averages. I get that some that's earlier, some that's later, some have kids earlier, some have kids later. But I hope that just by even seeing a few of those trends of what might be some of those mini 5-year, 10-year groupings, you can begin to see that there's a lot of pressure on young parents trying to figure this thing out. There's conflict, there's tiredness, there's stress, there's ultimatums that can be made. And so hopefully people can find some hope and renewal amidst the journey. And even some of those stats begin to give, I think, some evidence to where support might be needed, that practical support's probably the key thing for new parents. But then you want to get that community support into those kind of young childhood years, into some professional support as things really kind of come to a head, and hopefully people can figure out their appropriate right journey going forwards. And parenting's not an easy journey. It's a team sport in some ways, and I think that's where it's not just a couple, but it's also a community supporting that couple to really see the next generation thrive and flourish. And that's really my hope for everyone listening, that you can find the support you need at the stage you're at. And hopefully those stats aren't too somber and doom and gloom. But I think for parents, you're aware there's challenges and there's conflict and there's tension, and it's not just about compromise, but it's about negotiation. It's about those practical adult conversations to find hopefully some really helpful solutions going forwards.
Yeah, I think it's really fascinating, those stats that you share there, Geoff. And like you said, there are some sobering ones. And of course, because someone's a certain age doesn't mean that that's ahead of them, because like you said, they're averages. Mm-hmm. But I think it is helpful to use the data here to, I guess, paint that picture, and for people to just be aware of, on average, where challenges come up or where people do experience often some challenges with regards to relationships and marriage breakdowns. And like you said, to take the appropriate, I guess, action to prevent that happening for ourselves or for yourself. Yeah. And then to hopefully, yeah, seek out advice and community, like you said, and the antidote to some of that perhaps.
Yeah. And I think the business metaphor is the good to great, I guess, legendary business book is about step one to becoming a great company is you've got to face the brutal facts. And so relationships don't always work out. Parenting isn't an easy journey. And so just to have those in your mind as you kind of walk that road, wherever you might be at, or supporting others around you, hopefully those stats help you face some brutal facts and then prepare. Oh, all right, we're in the first 5 years of marriage, got a couple of young kids. Great. This is what we might need to build in. Or, hey, we're in the 10-year mark. I'm 11 years married now, and it's not all smooth sailing. There's bumps, and I love my wife. She's beautiful, and we're working out a relationship together. It's a journey. It's a process. And so I hope that gives some practical help for people as they face the facts, but then hopefully can find a road ahead that, yeah, really builds their relationship.
Yeah, absolutely. It's really, really great advice and research, I think, to be able to share. Back to, I guess, the focus on the kids and the parents. And I think it's fascinating. One thing that really resonates with me, and I've mentioned it on the podcast before, is the idea of tensions and the fact that life is not always good or bad, or relationships are not all good or bad, or, you know, nothing's all benefit and or challenge. It's always a mixture of both in different seasons and contexts. And I think one thing that I learned at a conference that I attended a few years ago about Generation Alpha was some research that they had shared about the different tensions that parents of this generation particularly are facing. Now, we're not saying that previous generations of parents didn't face any tensions, and some of these are probably timeless and others are a bit newer with the introduction of new technologies and the different challenges or the different contexts that that represents. So I wonder, Geoff, if you could share, again, from research and from your own experience around some of the tensions that exist for fathers, but I guess just in general for parents today, particularly, I guess, for this newest, youngest generation that are being shaped in the first to be shaped in the 21st century and a really different generation to generations past.
Yeah, I think the obvious one is around the digital tension that parents are wrestling with, and that's they want their children to have digital intelligence and be literate online, and yet they want them to be safe and avoid cyber scams and cyber predators. So I think that digital tension is one, and that's sort of balancing that screen time with green time, where parents want to have kids that are learning how to code, and my kids are, we've just had the Minecraft conversation in the last month about how can we build in some healthy habits around playing Minecraft. And I think it's balancing that with time out, playing soccer with the kids in the neighborhood, and getting out there, having some physical activity. So I think the digital tension is one. I think the physical development is another one, where we want to give our kids activities. We want to see them do swimming lessons, and we want to see them grow up. And I'm parents of young kids, so I appreciate all my examples are coming from that area. But it's balancing the physical development with just having rest and downtime as well. And that's not necessarily screen time, but just it's okay to go and flick through your Pokemon cards in your room, read a book, go and do some drawing, go and jump on the trampoline if you've got one of those in your backyard. So finding those opportunities, I think, for development across a few different areas is key for our children, let alone all the opportunities to develop them in kind of cultural intelligence or financial intelligence, how to be an entrepreneur, how to start a side hustle when they're young so that they'll kind of have an advantage financially and in the business world going forwards. There's so many different tensions I think parents are wrestling with of what should I do to develop my child. So I think it's pretty interesting to consider what I guess might be past ways that people were parented, and think about your own journey and what did your parents prioritize teaching you? What were the mantras that you've kind of got ingrained into your psyche and that just seemed to spill out of you as a father? I was listening to Joe Brum, the creator of Bluey, on an episode with Hamish Blake on his podcast on How Are the Dad's Dad. And he talks about these mantras that just kind of spill out of you as a dad. And you just think, oh, I didn't know that I supported that, but now I can see as a dad, I do reiterate those same sayings. And I think as dads of Gen Alpha kids, it's really important that we kind of have a focus in our parenting. We don't just sort of have a laissez-faire, whatever happens, happens kind of approach. We need to pick the lane we want our children to kind of develop in and prioritize that, focus that, and really be intentional. So we'd encourage parents to spend some time having some conversations and doing a bit of a reflection as well about what are those tensions you're wrestling with and what are those priorities that are important to you, because that's the values-based parenting, I think, that Gen Y parent would bring, that's maybe a little bit more focused and intentional than earlier generations. I might be wrong there, but that's my hunch.
No, I think it's spot on, and I think it's what we've seen in our research broadly and what I've seen as well. And I think, yeah, the technology, like even when we were doing research for the Generation Alpha book, anytime we spoke to anyone about how people perceive the next generation of children to be different to those in the past, because of course there are timeless, forever kind of important things around belonging and safety and acceptance and love, but the context in which all of that is trying to, I guess, be achieved is quite different for young people today, particularly because of technology. And we put this DCBA approach to technology use in the Generation Alpha book to try and give some practical guidelines or tips to parents to help them in that journey. And the D was for delay and limit, where we wrote, you know, delay is as much as possible and appropriate for your children and their development, the age when a child gets their own device. And we acknowledge that it's definitely a battle in those kind of childhood years. But we kind of recognize there that allowing kids to have that youthful existence without some of those pressures is important to communicate values and for parents to be clear and consistent about what behavior and standards are acceptable in their family with regards to device use. The behavioral strategies is what the B stands for around modeling and training children in how to manage device use when they're young, so they can apply that as they get older and gain independence. And then the A was for accountability. And again, that was kind of just reiterating that it's important for parents to remember that almost without exception, they're the internet account holders, they pay the bills and the devices. And so there is that ownership and responsibility on the parents, especially when kids are really young, to kind of manage that for them. But I mean, it's definitely new challenges facing parents and fathers of Gen Alpha with regards to technology and those conversations around Minecraft and what's real news that we're learning from famous YouTubers online and all those kind of things that previous generations of parents didn't really have to navigate as much.
Yeah, I think that 2 pages in the 300 and however many pages of Gen Alpha book were the most helpful for me as a young dad. Really encourage people to read that as a parent, but even just to think about your own digital behaviors and habits and screen usage. It's interesting teaching your kids to have a certain time limit, but then to think back to yourself and go, do I have any kind of suggested parameters around my screen usage and time limits? If I'm suggesting it's good for them, it's probably good for yourself as well. I'm trying to reflect on that at the moment. My kids, you can shoot me a message and see if this is working, folks. I'm happy to share openly here because my kids are playing Minecraft and we're trying to do a 3 20-minute token system where they've got to kind of ask, can they use it at that time? So it means we can get them motivated to do the morning routine and get a quick token in before they go, so they get 20 minutes. And it's making me think, do I have any behaviors like that would be helpful for me as an adult to kind of focus and limit my screen time? And there's a lot of fun on online, but I think we're really trying to look for what are those boundaries that are helpful, because we know there are some challenges around those online behaviors that can time can just slide on by, and you can do that brave thing of opening up your device and looking at your screen time usage and see how many hours per day you're on there and what apps you're using. And so I found there was a Instagram I was using a lot, so I've set a time limit on how much on Instagram I'm using per day, and I get a little message pop up on my screen when I've spent more than the allocated time. So it's interesting to see that DCBA is great for our kids, but I think as listeners as well, we can consider our own digital behaviors. So not trying to be too much of a sour voice on here today, Ash. Hopefully it's helpful advice for people, but I'm really challenged as a dad to demonstrate good behavior and not just say one thing and do another. I think that authenticity is key as we raise kids, so that they actually look up to us as parents. And I think we can be their biggest heroes if we're living a bold and amazing life and genuine and real about the struggles we've had and how we choose to make decisions as well. And they're great conversations to have with kids and partners in the home.
Yeah, I think it's so helpful even just to be raw and authentic and vulnerable and to share the struggles and to share where the tensions are, because it shows the power of stories in helping people know they're not alone and that there are things that other parents are feeling. And I think, yeah, even just around the evolution of our communities and how, I guess, historically, I haven't looked into this too much, but I was just listening to a podcast on it recently about how historically that was more that tribe mentality and we're never actually intended to do these things, especially around parenting, you know, alone. And so the benefit of hearing other people's journeys or stories or advice and empathizing with that is even just such an important aspect for parents, you know, just to feel heard and seen. So I'm sure that's really helpful for many of our listeners. Geoff, in terms of helpfulness, you've mentioned a couple of books and podcasts. Do you have any other particular ones that kind of stand out that you feel like people should go and investigate, and those who really want a deep dive will send you a message on LinkedIn, I'm sure, but any other recommendations?
Yeah. Oh, there's a few that I think come to mind. So yeah, there's a great book, Generation Alpha. I'll be silly not to mention it. It's written by the wonderful Ashley Fell and Mark McCrindle. And that's really building on decades of social research from Mark, and Ash has been in this game for 10 years now. And I think the two of them, you might not have kids, Ash, but you've got a great grasp of what the challenges are for parents and what the experience is like for today's kids. I know you're a Gen Alpha and Gen Z expert, so got to recommend that book. And hand on heart, it helped me enormously as a parent. So thank you for writing it and helping me on my journey. I think probably other resources. I've mentioned Steve Bidoff is a brilliant voice and author. He's got some great books. There's a podcast I was on recently that I'm enjoying getting into, and that's called Dad's Group. So a bit of a disclaimer, I was on it. That's why I've heard about it and really enjoyed it. But yeah, I think those kind of resources, there's a few other parenting ones. I can't remember the exact titles. There's so many different ones I've subscribed to, and I just sort of click through interesting titles as they pop up. But I'd encourage people to find your own kind of inspiration, and that might be, yeah, a well-known or a really small niche approach to parenting that really suits your style. Because I think that's the era we're in. We're not just in one mass market approach to parenting. We're not just helicopter parents, or we're not just this or that. There's so many styles. And so finding your own kind of inspo, looking for advice, finding those people you can reach out to. And I'd encourage every dad to listen to one podcast at least in the next week. Try and get out there and take some time to learn a new aspect of parenthood that will help you, help your partner, help your children. We can take small steps as dad, but they can have huge impacts and influences. If you learn one new skill that you can drop into your weekly routine, it might be getting home and just putting the phone down for an hour and just being present, being involved, listening to people's days, helping with homework, being respectful and caring of your partner. Those little steps can have a huge impact. So you might just learn one thing in the next week as a dad that might help you for the next decade. So I encourage you to get out there and seek some good input into your life. So hope that's encouraging for people.
Yeah, and so fitting with Father's Day around the corner, and as we celebrate the great work, I think as always, all of us as human beings in every sphere of life, but especially I'm sure with regards to parenting, can always be reflecting and learning new things. And I mean, like you said, especially if we're talking to parents who are in those really tired years, it can be a lot to navigate with work and with kids. But like you said, it's going to benefit generations to come. Potentially, it's definitely a worthwhile investment. And yeah, even podcasts, you can listen to them while you're driving, or they're such easy ways to absorb information and challenge yourself. So really fantastic advice, Geoff. It would be amiss of us, I think, of me to end the podcast without asking for a dad joke. I think as one of our colleagues, when we were in our colleague Luke, when we were talking about the conception of this episode, he was like, you got to tell a dad joke. So Geoff, any dad jokes to end the episode with?
Give one a crack. Yeah, absolutely. Why couldn't the business owner hear his accountant speaking outside his office? Because he was using his invoice.
I love a pun. I don't know if puns equal dad jokes. I feel like they do, but I love a good pun.
they're so fun watching and learning all the dad jokes. It's a it's not really an art. I think I've heard it described as the lowest form of humor, which means it's accessible. Kids get it, adults get it. I think we enjoy it.
It's inclusive. It's building
community.
It's not
very complicated. it's good fun. Thanks for letting me share one, Ash.
No, we love it. And thank you, Geoff. Thanks for modeling such great dad behavior, and for being honest about struggles and tensions and doing a lot of this research and sharing it with us today. Really appreciate your time and effort.
Thanks, Ash, and go well to all the dads. You're doing great. Keep going. And all the mums supporting them. You're doing awesome.
Yeah, absolutely. And happy Father's Day to all the dads listening, and to you, Geoff, as well. And for our listeners, if you'd like to stay up to date with more insights and our latest insights at McCrindle, you can always subscribe to the podcast. You can follow us on social media, or you can head to McCrindle.com to find out more. So as always, thank you for listening, and goodbye for now.